Hey, good morning, everyone. Welcome to yet another online session on principles of communication system. So we have been discussing about frequency modulation. So in last session, we have discussed about the properties of Bessel's function and also considerations when it comes to transmission bandwidth of frequency modulated system. Right. So we have seen there are different approaches. One of them would be actually what the empirical relation, using an empirical relation to obtain the approximate bandwidth, right? So that was Carson's rule, right? So what was Carson's rule? What was that empirical relation? Right, it gives total bandwidth, right? The total bandwidth can be approximately, it is approximately equal to say 2 delta F plus 2 FM, or we can rewrite it as 2 delta F times 1 plus 1 by beta, right? So maybe given, right, so in today's session we'll discuss about generation of FM, but we'll have a quick recap before that, right? So it's a quick recap, right? So given if delta F is equal to say 75 kilohertz, if delta F is equal to 75 kilohertz and this FM or W, right, it is equal to say 15 kilohertz, what will be the required bandwidth as per Carson's rule? Right, you can just evaluate and type it in chat window. Right, what is the required bandwidth for FM according to Carson's rule? Now, delta F was given to be equal to 75 kilohertz, right? So these values are actually what for commercial FM radio broadcast in US, right? So these values, delta F and FM values, right? So it limits the, or it assume it can like accept a message frequency up to 15 kilohertz, right? And the maximum frequency deviation allowed us 75 kilohertz. Maybe it has got something to do with the channel separation, right? So now please find out what is BT, right? You find out what is BT and type it in chat window, right? I'll consider this for your attendance. What is BT according to Carson's rule? Right. So it is, yeah, please type in. It's quite straightforward, right? What is it? It is 2 times delta F plus 2 times FM, right? So in this case, what can be the maximum value of beta, right? In this case, what can be the maximum value of beta, right? It will be delta F by FM, delta F by FM, and if you calculate it, it will be equal to what? 75k divided by 15k. Right, so it will be equal to 5. Right, so beta value will be 5. So if you calculate using Carson's formula, the bandwidth required, you will get equal to 180 kilohertz, and you will get that equal to 180 kilohertz. But instead, right, you evaluate beta, right, maximum beta or deviation ratio, whatever you can call, right, and you got this beta to be equal to 5. And I have also mentioned about a universal curve for evaluating 1% bandwidth. If you remember that, right, it was some curve which is like this, right, some curve which is like this. So in this curve, the y-axis was say total bandwidth by delta F, right, total bandwidth by delta F, right, and the x-axis was beta, right. Now in this graph, you find out what would be the value of BT by delta F, right. Say if this is equal to, if this is beta equal to say 5, so maybe beta equal to 5 may come somewhere here, right? If this is beta equal to 5, right, so then if you can find the corresponding value of, right, BT by delta F, right, so you will get, right, so you will get it approximately equal to 240 kilohertz, right? So this will be, you'll get BT to be equal to 240 kilohertz, or you'll get BT by delta f is equal to actually what? It will be 240 by 75k. This is what you will get, right? So this will be 240 by 75, this value, and BT you will get, it is equal to 240 kilohertz. So from this example, what you can infer is, when we use this Carson's rule, it actually underestimates the required bandwidth, right? So this, in last class itself, I told this universal curve, right? Universal curve for 1% universal curve for 1% bandwidth, right? 1% bandwidth, right? This is more accurate compared to Carson's rule, right? So in this case, the bandwidth given by the universal curve was 240 kilohertz, and that given by Carson's rule is 180 kilohertz. So it's almost actually what so it's almost 3/4 of the required bandwidth. So the error is approximately, you can say it is equal to 25%, right? So there is a 25% error when we use Carson's rule. But in case if no details about universal curve was given, right, if only delta f and fm or any standard expression is given, you can always use Carson's rule to evaluate the approximate bandwidth, right? So but just keep in mind, if Carson's rule sort of underestimates the required bandwidth, right? So I just wanted to solve that example, right? So I hope that is clear. Now with that note, we'll move on to generation of, right, in this section we'll discuss about generation of FM signals, right? Generation of FM signals, right? So generation of FM signal, normally, like in some textbook, actually what classifies it into direct and indirect method, right? So in our textbook, they have shown a direct method and how to extend that direct method to obtain a wideband FM, right? So that method in which is mentioned in your textbook as an means of obtaining wideband FM, that is actually what indirect method, right? So I'll discuss both, right? So if for generation of FM signal, first we have this direct method, right? Direct method or direct FM system, right? Or direct FM system, right? So as the name suggests, right, in direct method or direct FM system, what happens is the instantaneous frequency, maybe I'll write it down, you have to note it down, right? The instantaneous frequency of carrier is varied directly according to the our m of t, our message signal, right? For this, right, we are using a device which is called, actually what, using a voltage controlled oscillator. We'll be using a device which is called voltage controlled oscillator, right, or VCO. So about this VCO and phase lock loop, in next section we'll study in detail, right? So what happens in direct method is a carrier, so there is a system which uses a particular carrier frequency. That carrier frequency is varied directly in according to the message signal amplitude, right? So that is, as the name suggests, a direct system. So this voltage controlled oscillator, it is something whose output frequency, right, output frequency will vary according to some voltage which is input, right? So that is a voltage controlled oscillator. And one of the simplest way to demonstrate a voltage controlled oscillator, it's actually what a sinusoidal oscillator, right? That is Hartley oscillator. So maybe I'll just draw a sort of schematic of Hartley oscillator, right? So a Hartley oscillator, it will of course have a transistor, right? So there will be right, this is the network, right, which determines the frequency, or resonant network which determines the frequency. So there will be inductor 1, inductor 2, and there will also be a capacitor, right? There will also be a capacitor, right? So then, so I have not shown any what DC bias and all those aspects here, right? So this is a typical Hartley oscillator, right? So this L1, L2, and say I'll call C, right? Initially I'll call C. This network, right? This is a feedback network, right? Which provides actually what a sort of positive feedback, right? So that there will be oscillation. This combination of L1, L2, and C determines the frequency of oscillation. So maybe we can call it actually what frequency determining resonant network, right? So this is L1, L2, combination of L1, L2, and C is a frequency determining resonant network, right? So, and this is a Hartley oscillator, right? You might have studied this in smaller classes, right? Hartley oscillators, Kolpit oscillators, all those things, right? So this normally Hartley oscillators, it can produce a range of frequencies from say 30 kilohertz to some say 30 megahertz, right? So that range of frequencies it can generate, right? So Hartley oscillator, right? So can anyone tell me what is the frequency of oscillation of an Hartley oscillator which has this configuration, right? This is L1, L2, and C. You might have studied this, right? So instantaneous frequency, right? Fi of t, or I'll write F only now, right? Maybe late, right? F is equal to 1 by 2 pi root of L1 plus L2 times C. So this is the frequency of oscillation of a Hartley oscillator, right? So in this, right, if we can, this capacitive element of this frequency determining network, right, if we are making it a variable capacitor or a varactor, right, so a varactor or a variable capacitor, it is nothing but what its capacitance will change according to the terminal voltage. So if you are applying the, right, if you are applying m of t across this, right, if you are applying m of t across this c of t, right, so if it is a variable capacitor, I should show like this, right? So I should show this is a symbol of a variable capacitor. So whenever, if I am applying m of t across this variable capacitor, according to the instantaneous voltage, the capacitance value will change, right? If the capacitance value is changing, what will happen? This frequency, instantaneous frequency will become, if L1, L2, and C are constant, right? So you will get a sustained oscillation at frequency 1 by 2 pi root of L1 plus L2 LC, L1 plus L2 times C. But if the C is a variable capacitor or a varactor, right, whose capacitance is changing according to M of T, then this instantaneous frequency also will change according to this C of T, right? So this is a typical actually what voltage controlled oscillator, right? And the C of T, how this C of T actually, right, maybe the C of T, right, it in fact is constructed like this. There will be a fixed resistance, right? There will be a fixed resistance, and in shunt to that there will be a variable capacitor, right? So not resistance, I meant capacitor, right? So you can call it CF or C naught, right? And this is a variable capacitor. It will be actually what a function of time, right? And in fact it will be a function of the applied voltage, right, across this. So I am writing it as C of V of T, which means capacitance will be a function of the voltage applied across its terminal, right? So this is a variable capacitor. So this is how this capacitive element is constructed in a VCO, right, if it uses Hartley oscillator. So what will be the total capacitance, right, the total capacitance C of T, right, the total capacitance C of T will be equal to, when capacitance are in shunt, it will be C naught plus C of V of T. When I write C of V of T, which means the C is a function of voltage, right? So this is the this is the capacitance, right? Now please remember this is the instantaneous frequency. This is the expression for instantaneous frequency. So as this capacitive element is a function of time, right, this instantaneous frequency will vary according to that, right? So next, what we can assume, right, a single tone system, right? We can assume a m of t to be equal to, say, cos 2 pi fmt, right? So let us assume this m of t, the message signal, is equal to cos 2 pi fmt. So the message frequency is fm, right? So in this case, right, in this case, what we can write is, we can write the c of t, right, the c of t can be written as c0 plus delta c times cos 2 pi fm t, right, where the c0, right, the c0 is the capacitance when no voltage is applied, right, when no external voltage is applied, right, c0, it is the capacitance when no voltage is applied, and this delta c, it is the maximum deviation of the capacitance, right, like how we have seen delta f, that is the maximum frequency deviation, right, centered at fc. So similarly, this delta c, right, it is a maximum frequency deviation, right, and this variable capacitance part, we can define it like this: delta c times cos 2 pi fmt. So the c of t can swing between c0 plus delta c or c0 minus delta c, according to what cos 2 pi fct is plus 1 or minus 1, and the value will lie in between, right? The value of c of t will lie in between c0 minus delta c and c0 plus delta c. So the c of t is this, right? So for a single tone modulation, we can assume c of t to be equal to this. So now what we have done is, and we'll just recollect, right? So we have a Hartley oscillator in which the capacitive element is time varying, right? It essentially is constructed like this: a fixed capacitance in parallel with a varector, right? So it can be a varector, right, or you can even call a variable capacitor, right, varicap, right, or variable capacitor, right, anything you can call, right. So this is actually what a constant, right, when two capacitance are in shunt, the effective capacitance will be the sum, right. So and the c of v of t, right, assuming this m of t to be cos 2 pi fct, we can write it as delta c times cos 2 pi fmt. So it will change according to the message signal. This is actually what c v of t, right? It will change according to the message signal, right? So this is our c of t. Now what we will do is, we'll substitute this in our expression for instantaneous frequency. So if you remember, expression for instantaneous frequency of Hartley oscillator is 1 divided by 2 pi times root of L1 plus L2 times, and C actually what? C0 plus delta C times cos 2 pi fmt, right? C0 times delta C plus cos 2 pi fmt. So when there is no voltage is applied, when this cos 2 pi fmt, this entire thing is zero, right? Just assume when this entire thing is zero, right, when this cos 2 pi fmt or the m of t is zero, what will happen? The instantaneous frequency will be a constant, and that will be equal to actually what? 1 by 2 pi root of L1 plus L2 times C0, right? So when no m of t is applied, right, we can say fi of t will be equal to a constant, that is equal to f0, that will be equal to actually what? 1 by 2 pi root of L1 plus L2 times C0, where the C0 is the capacitance in the absence of applied message voltage across the terminal, right? So so this is FO, right? So I just introduced this term to you now, right? Now what we can do is, maybe we can write this FI of t in terms of this center frequency, right, or unmodulated carrier frequency, right, This is the FO, you can consider it as actually what the sender frequency or unmodulated carrier frequency, right? But when you apply the message, this cos 2 pi fmt, delta C cos 2 pi fmt will be non-zero. Accordingly, the frequency will deviate on either sides of FO. Fine. So now we can, in the presence of message signal, Fi of t will be equal to, I'm just rewriting it, 1 by 2 pi root of time L1 plus L2, right? This is m of t not equal to 0, right? L1 plus L2 times, what I'm doing is I'm just taking the C naught out, right? I'm just from this square bracket, I'm taking this C naught out, right? So what I'll get is the C naught times 1 plus delta C by C naught times cos 2 pi FMT. Right. So we'll get this. Now, you know this is equal to like 1 divided by 2 pi root of L1 plus L2 into C naught, right, times root of 1 plus delta C by C naught cos 2 pi FMT. Right, this entire thing. Right. So then what is this 1 by 2 pi root of L1 plus L2 times C naught? We can write it as F naught. Right. So I'm writing it. This is equal to F naught into, right, this root of something, it is actually what? Something power half. Right. So this root in the denominator, I can bring it to the numerator and I can write it as 1 plus delta C by C naught cos 2 pi FMT to the power minus half. Right. So why? Because root x is actually what? X power half, and 1 by root x equal to x power minus half. Right. So I've written it like this. Right. So, and this is equal to, right. And I hope you remember, right, something called binomial expansion or binomial series. Anybody remember that? Right, anybody remember what is binomial series or binomial expansion? Please type yes or no. So I'll give you a small task, right? So maybe you can just Google and find out what, according to a binomial theorem, what is 1 plus x to the power n, right? What is 1 plus x to the power n? Given x is much less compared to 1, right? Given x is much less compared to 1, what is 1 plus x to the power n according to binomial expansion or binomial theorem? Maybe you can just Google and find out, right? All of you, please do it. Right. I'll give you 2 minutes of time. What is 1 plus x to the power n? And the person who is giving answer fast will get some reward for sure. I hope the question is clear. What is 1 plus x to the power n? And n can be any number, any positive or negative number, right? And the constraint is x is much less compared to 1. X is a small value compared to 1. Yeah, I'm waiting for response. Right. Didn't see any response yet. Right. You can, I told you, can just Google and find out. No problem with that. Yeah. No answer yet. Or if you can tell me what is 1 plus x to the power minus half or 1 plus x to the power half, that also would be fine. Right. But I prefer 1 plus x to the power n according to binomial expansion or binomial theorem. Yeah, maybe I'll wait for one more minute. Within that, I'm expecting some answer. Yeah, Savan has given 1 plus x to the 1 plus nx plus n into n minus 1 times x square n into n minus 1 times n minus 2. Oh, something is missing, Savan. Right. Whatever you have typed here, right. Something is missing. Right. You are almost there. Yes, so now answer is coming. So it's n into n minus 1 by 2 factorial by 3 factorial. That is what was missed in Savan. But anyhow, Savan has given first answer. There was like a slight mistake. And then Swaroop, right. And Shreyas has given infinite number of terms. Excellent. Right. Right. And Sahana has typed it is 1 plus nx. Right. Okay. Good. That is what we have to use. Right. Okay. Fine. So I'm getting Sanket. Okay. It's copy. But I didn't tell you not to copy paste. Right. You can copy paste. Not a problem. Right. Okay. Fine. Good that you are able to find it. Right. So 1 plus x to the power n according to binomial theorem will be 1 plus nx plus n into n minus 1 divided by 2 factorial times x square plus n into n minus 1 times n minus 2 divided by 3 factorial times x cube plus so on and so forth. Right. So this is our expansion. But I told x, if x is very small, right, if x is approximately equal to 0, say it is 0.001. Right. So it will be if x is 0.001, right, so it will be 1 plus n into 0.001. But what will be x square will be 0.00000. Right. So there will be say more zeros. It is 10 power minus 3. So it will be 10 power. It will become actually what 10 power minus 6. Right. And cube will be 10 power. Square 10 power minus 9, right? So when x is very small, if x is much less compared to 1, right, what we can do is we can approximate this 1 plus, right, this 1 plus x to the power n can be approximated to be equal to 1 plus nx. Why? Because this x square, x cube, all those things will be what, very small compared to, right, 1. So we can conveniently neglect it, right? So those will contribute only to maybe what, 6th or 7th or 8th or 9th decimal places, right? So we can conveniently neglect it, right? So we can assume 1 plus x to the power n is approximately equal to 1 plus nx. I think someone has typed that in. Sahana typed, I think. Sahana typed 1 plus nx, right? So that is true only when x is right, very small compared to 1, and also so it is okay according to our requirement, right? So that is so now what will be 1 plus x to the power minus half 1 plus, so now what we have here is, right, we have 1 plus delta c by c naught cos 2 pi fm t to the power minus half, right? So this if you assume this delta c, capacitance deviation is very small compared to c naught, so I'll rewrite it here. So now we need to find an approximation of 1 plus delta c by c naught, right, cos 2 pi fm t, right, to the power minus half, right? We need to find an approximation of this, right? So if we assume delta c is much less compared to C naught, right? So this entire term will be actually what? Much, much less compared to 1 at any given time, right? At any given time, this term will be much less compared to 1. So by means of binomial expansion, right? So here, if you call this is x, right? And our n is minus half. So 1 plus x to the power minus half, it will be equal to what? 1 plus nx, right? So in this case, x is this and n is equal to minus 1 by 2. So we can approximate this. We can approximate this to be equal to 1 plus nx, right? So n is minus half. So it will be 1 minus delta c by 2 c naught times cos 2 pi fm t, right? So this is, we can rewrite it like this. So if you put this in the expression for fi of t, so fi of t becomes f naught into 1 minus delta c by 2 c naught times cos 2 pi fm t, right? Delta c by c naught times cos 2 pi fm t. So this is what we'll get if you use a Hartley oscillator with a frequency determining capacitive element to be a variable capacitor, right? So then we'll get instantaneous frequency, which will be a function of the message signal, right? Instantaneous frequency, which will be a function of message signal, right? Now we know for fm, right, what actually should be the instantaneous frequency? Fi of t should be equal to, say, f naught, right, plus say delta f, right, f naught times delta f cos 2 pi fm t. So this should be the instantaneous frequency of fm. So we have discussed it in the first class itself, right? So where this delta f is frequency deviation. So now if we compare this, right, so I can rewrite this as it is f0 delta c by 2 c naught, f0 delta c by 2 c naught times cos 2 pi fmt, right? Cos 2 pi fmt, right? So now if we have to compare these two, so right, if we substitute, let say delta c by 2 c naught is equal to delta f by fm. If we substitute, right, delta f by fm or delta f by f naught, whatever, right? Yeah, delta f by fm if we substitute, right? Or delta f, can substitute delta f by f naught, right? So this delta c by c naught is equal to delta f by f naught, right? Which implies this fi of t, right? Fi of t from this, right? Fi of t will be equal to f naught times 1 minus delta f by f naught times cos 2 pi fmt. Our aim is to what? Bring it into standard format. So if you expand it, it will become actually what? F0 minus this f0 and f0 will get cancelled in this. So it will become plus, right? This, if this is delta c by 2 c naught, if we substitute it equal to minus delta f by f naught, we need in this format. For that, you have to make a substitution, delta c by 2 c naught to be equal to frequency deviation divided by f naught, right? So we'll get this, right? So f0 plus, when you expand f0, this delta f naught and f naught will get cancelled, we'll get f0 plus delta f times cos 2 pi fm t. So this is a instantaneous frequency, right, of the modulated signal, right, when we use a indirect method for frequency modulation, right? So this is, right, according to what we have learned, right, this is how frequency will change, frequency will vary, right? So this is actually what indirect method. Indirect method using, say, maybe one method of implementing a VCO is what we have seen now, using a Hartley oscillator, right? So if in case you are asked to write about indirect method, this is what you have to write. So this is frequency. Instantaneous frequency is actually what 1 by 2 pi root of L1 plus L2 into C, where the C, it is a capacitor in shunt with a varector, right? So then what happens? So this is how we have derived. Any doubt in this? If you have any doubt, please feel free to ask or type in. If you have any doubt, please feel free to type in. Right. Okay. I hope no doubt. Right. So now the problem is, in this case, I told initially itself, this sort of sinusoidal oscillator, most of them, it can give you a frequency from say 30 kilohertz to say some 30 megahertz. Right. But if you see the applications of FM, right, it was used in actually what first generation mobile communication system, that is called actually what AMPS, right, advanced mobile phone system, wherein the frequency used was around actually what say around 800 to 900 megahertz, right, 800 to 900 megahertz, that is the frequency used. But here, if you are using a VCO, right, what it gives is a narrow band FM, right? But if you want to go for a wide band FM, right, so with center frequency somewhere around this and a much larger frequency deviation, right, then we should go for this indirect method, right? We should go for the indirect method. So in indirect method, what happens is, initially you will generate a narrow band FM using a direct method, right? Then you will use a series of say frequency multipliers and mixers, and you will translate this frequency to a much higher frequency. Right, so if, you might have studied about frequency multiplier, maybe in digital circuits you might have studied. Right, so frequency multiplier, it produces harmonics of the input frequency. If you give a frequency F naught at the input, it can give you actually what 2 F naught, 3 F naught, and right. So as you might have studied this in reference with actually what clock frequency, right, and right. So that is actually what generally, if you want to generate a wideband FM, right, generation of wideband FM. So wideband FM generation, right, maybe a general block diagram, right, can be drawn like this, right? So you have to use a VCO. VCO is nothing but what, voltage controlled oscillator, right? So to its input you will be giving M of T, right? This VCO, what it does is, its oscillator output will vary directly according to M of T. So this VCO part is actually what, it's a direct modulator. But normal sinusoidal oscillators which we use, it can give up to actually what say 30 megahertz or so. So if you have to translate the frequency up, we should use further stages of actually what frequency multipliers or mixers, right, and so on, right? So if after this VCO, if you use a frequency multiplier, right, then followed by, right, you will use actually what's a mixer. What a mixer does, right, a mixer, it takes two inputs, right, it will give the sum and difference frequencies, right, and here maybe you can use some other fixed oscillator which oscillates at a higher frequency, right, which oscillates at higher frequency. So or maybe a more stable oscillator like crystal oscillator can be used. But if you use crystal oscillator, you can't control the frequency, right? So you should use some oscillator, right? So in VCO you have to use actually what, some oscillator which has a frequency determining network, right? Here you can use fixed oscillator, and you can again actually what translate the frequency up, right? And you can include many stages, right? So maybe one more frequency multiplier you can include, right? One more frequency multiplier, right? And finally, right, after all the stages, if you get the required say center frequency, you can just right pass it through some bandpass filter, right? At the end, you can pass it through some bandpass filter, and that will be your WBFM output, right? WBFM output, right? So that will be your WBFM output. So this frequency multiplier, what it does is basically it can generate harmonics of the input frequency, right? And a mixer, it can give sum and difference, right? And normally a mixer will have right an inbuilt low pass filter or high pass filter in between. So as our aim is to translate the frequency up or upscale the frequency, so it can have an inbuilt low pass filter which will remove or eliminate the difference frequencies, and it will allow only the sum frequencies. And again, it can be frequency translated. So one typical example would be, what if you are using an Hartley oscillator to generate a narrow band FM, at the maximum center frequency which it can have is actually what, 30 megahertz, right? So after these this process, you can actually what scale it up to say 800 to 900 megahertz, right? So that is how we can generate wideband FM. But an inherent problem with this using VCO or direct method, whatever is, right, the sort of sinusoidal oscillator which we are using, they are not stable, right? The issue is, or problem is, right, the sinusoidal oscillator, it won't give actually what a stable frequency output, right? Even if you don't apply message signal, the if you might have observed in lab, right, the frequency, it will vary on its own. So if without applying message signal, if there is some deviation in frequency, that is actually what, some offset, or that is error, right? So that is an issue. So in order to overcome that, right, so we can have a feedback scheme, right, so to stabilize the frequency, right? So the issue is the sinusoidal oscillator, right, it's not stable, right, no stability, right, no stability. So in order to overcome this, we can have a frequency stabilization scheme. So to stabilize frequency, maybe I'll write frequency stabilization, to stabilize frequency, right? So what we can do is we can have a feedback scheme. Right, a feedback scheme. I'll draw the feedback scheme here. So as usual, we have this voltage controlled oscillator within this VCO. We will have some oscillator which is not that stable, right? So we are giving m of t, we're giving m of t here, right? Then right, we have this fm, right, fm output. We have fm output. So we want to have some feedback system. So what we'll do is we'll tap this, right, FM output here. We'll give it to a mixer, right? We'll give it to a mixer, right? And you know, mixer is actually what it expects two inputs. So one input will be actually what, FM modulated output, right? FM modulated output, and other input will be actually what, a stable oscillator input. So maybe you can use a crystal oscillator. Right, it provides stable input, right? So then after this mixer, right, we can have a frequency discriminator, right? After this mixer, we can have a frequency discriminator, right? And the frequency discriminator output can be fed to a low pass filter, and That in turn has given us actually what control signal to a VCC that is fed back to our voltage controlled oscillator, right? So this setup is constructed in such a way that if there is actually what deviation of carrier frequency, right, this VCO, it will have a carrier frequency or the center frequency F naught, right? If there is deviation in carrier frequency, right, so corresponding to that deviation, some error signal will be obtained at the output. If FC is exactly equal to F naught, right, this error signal will be zero. But if it deviates from the expected carrier frequency, that there will be error signal. That error signal will actually what compensate or it will eliminate that deviation in frequency. So this mixer basically what it does is it will produce actually what some difference frequencies, and this frequency discriminator, right, it will produce a voltage, right, frequency discriminator here, it will produce a voltage which is according to the input frequency, right? So that is how we can have frequency stabilization, right? So frequency, what you have to keep in mind is that this error voltage will be equal to zero when there is the carrier frequency is exactly the same what we need, right? If it is deviating, this feedback system will give some error voltage, and that error voltage will adjust the carrier frequency accordingly, right? So that is this. Right, so this frequency discriminator, its output amplitude, its output amplitude will be a function of input frequency, whatever frequency we are giving here, right? So depending upon that, you will get its output instantaneous amplitude. So the instantaneous amplitude of frequency discriminator will be a function of the instantaneous input frequency, right? So maybe in next section we study in detail about phase lock loop. So this is actually what something similar to phase lock loop. We can call it actually what a frequency locked loop, right? So a phase locked loop we have even seen in Costa's receiver, right? So in order to maintain phase synchronization, like we were using a phase locked loop and phase discriminator, right? So here, in order to maintain frequency stabilization, right, we will be using frequency discriminator and a low pass filter, right? So I hope this is clear. So if question is asked in exam, you should be able to draw this block diagram and explain what each block is, right, and what are the important drawbacks or how it is eliminated, all those aspects you should be able to write, right? So that's about actually what the generation of FM signal. Right, generation of FM signal. So in old scheme, actually we had phase modulation also, right? We had phase modulation also as a part of our syllabus, but now we don't have phase modulation. And normally they used to ask, right, how you can obtain a FM signal from a PM signal and PM signal from a FM signal and all those aspects. Those, as usual, what we'll do is, as it's not a direct part of our syllabus, we'll address it at the end, right? For now, right, we'll stick on to our syllabus, and this is what is there in your syllabus about generation of frequency, right? So a direct method is actually what you, the instantaneous amplitude of the message will decide what should be the oscillator frequency, and for that we are using some device which is called voltage controlled oscillator, and we have seen how to realize a voltage controlled oscillator. It's actually what a simple Hartley oscillator, wherein the capacitance component of the frequency determining network, right, we have used a varactor or varicap or variable capacitor, right, and using that we derived and showed that such a system can give us a FM modulated signal, right? Then we had an issue of, right, obtaining wideband FM signal. So to obtain wideband FM signal, what we can do is we can initially generate a narrowband FM signal, and we can pass it through a series of frequency multipliers, mixers, right? And at the end, you can, when the desired frequency is achieved, you can use a bandpass filter and obtain the FM modulated output. So in next session, we'll see frequency demodulation. So now before that, right, so this, how can we realize a variable capacitor, right? How can we realize a variable capacitor? Just out of curiosity, I'm asking, right? So a variable capacitor, right, it can be realized, right, using a PN junction, right, a PN junction, right? So if you reverse bias a PN junction, you can see there will be a depletion region, right? So when you apply more and more reverse bias voltage, what will happen? The depletion region width will increase, and there will be actually what, charge separation, right? Charge separation is there in depletion region. There won't be any mobile charge carriers, right? But when we have depletion region, right, so what will happen? On N side, we'll have a positive charge, and P side, we'll have actually what, P side of depletion region, we'll have negative charge. It's actually what, two equal and opposite charges separated by a distance. But as you increase the reverse bias voltage, what will happen? Width of the depletion region will increase, and of course, the charge also will actually what, charge explosion also will increase. So capacitance will vary accordingly. So that is a simple way to realize a variable capacitor is by using a PN junction, right? Normally, or else you can even use actually what, MOS capacitance, right? Whatever. So that is how we can implement a variable capacitor, right? So maybe that's all there in FM generation. Right. Next session, which is a recorded session, we will study about FM demodulation. Right. FM demodulation, and after that, we'll study about phase lock loop. Right. And maybe by this week, we'll try to wind up this module, and we'll move on to the third module or maybe fourth module. Right. Fourth module is about digital communication and maybe applications of FM. You already know it is used in actually what, FM radio broadcasting, right? You know, we initially itself we have discussed what is the frequency used, right? And why do we call FM more like high fidelity radio, right? So we have seen in AM, right? AM radio, it was allowing only the input frequency up to what, 5 kilohertz or 4 kilohertz, right? But FM, right, it is allowing FM or W up to actually what, 15 kilohertz. So it can capture more information in the audio signal, right? So, and of course, it is used in AMPS. AMPS is actually what, first generation mobile communication system, advanced mobile phone system, right? It was an analog system that time. Then later on, now what we have, everything is digital based systems, right? So those are the applications, right? And now maybe with one simple question, we will end this session, right? So I want all of you to just type in, what is the instantaneous frequency of a Hartley oscillator? Right, instantaneous frequency output of a Hartley oscillator, right? If L1, L2 and C, a fixed capacitor C, are used in the feedback network or frequency determining network, right? What is the instantaneous frequency? You can just type it in, right? And once you have typed it in, you can leave the meeting, right? So thank you in advance for joining this session. Right, so please do type in, what is the frequency of a Hartley oscillator output? And I didn't include any quiz as such. Why? Because we won't be having enough time. So maybe next sessions I'll include quizzes, right? But this, all of you have to type in, what is the frequency of Hartley oscillator output? with the tank circuit having inductors L1, L2 and capacitor C. Yeah, please do type it in. Yeah, people are typing it in 1 by 2 per root of L1 plus L2 times C. Yeah, those who have typed in can try. Yeah, okay, thank you. Right, those who have typed in. Okay, when one person types it in, others can copy paste it right easily. And I'm just looking for any different answers. Okay, fine. Thank you so much for joining. Right. Next, we have a session on Thursday that will be a recorded session. In that, I'll discuss about demodulation of FM signal.